Honorable Speaker, Honorable Prime Minister, the Honorable Leader of Opposition, and Honorable Members of August House, of this August House. Bulare and a very good evening. Mr. Speaker, sir, I am pleased to also make a contribution to the national budget for the new financial year. Mr. Speaker, sir, I commend government's confidence in preparing a bold, brave, and sensible budget, even while still coping with the impacts of the COVID-19, together with the devastation of Tropical Cyclone Harry. It is clear we were faced with more than a crisis of health, far more, crisis bigger than anything the world has seen in the last century. But given its nature and the unprecedented blows to our economy, we have shown through this budget our ability to provide steadfast direction and sound leadership guided by a beacon of hope. Mr. Speaker, sir, government recognized that in the new normal, it requires a carefully thought out budget that not only addresses the present, but takes stock of the future. Government has carefully crafted the 2020-2021 budget by prioritizing sectors that need to grow to support economic recovery. It empowers Fijian to fight back and rebuild their lives. This is truly the Fijian spirit of never giving up in the face of adversity. I am confident, as a small island state, we have portrayed our footprints globally and displayed our unity and resilience as a nation, even during crises and times of need. Mr. Speaker, sir, the Ministry of Rural and Maritime Development and Disaster Management is grateful for its budget allocation, 16.6 million. Mr. Speaker, sir, at this point, I acknowledge the support of merging the two institutions, Rural and Maritime Development and the National Disaster Management Office. This will obviously bring about efficiency through streamlining of systems and processes in the coordination of emergency operations during national disasters. This would set the platform for integrating disaster risk reduction in planning for development and disaster preparedness activities. The divisional coordination mechanism has gone through several national events and was again a vital link in the national campaign to address the COVID-19 pandemic. Mr. Speaker, sir, the reverse of rural to urban drift is possible when we are committed about raising standard of living in the rural areas. Even in times of crisis like that we are experiencing with COVID-19, we are seeing that this is possible. We are seeing the resilience of the rural economy and its lure for people affected by the economic growth, economic downturn. We have seen in the media and physically seen while visiting our community. Now men and women who have suffered job losses have returned to their village or farms to live off their land and also contribute positively to the progress of Fiji rural economy. Mr. Speaker, sir, given the vast and rich resources in rural areas, government can rely on these rural-based sectors as the new drivers of growth to support the tourism industry. This can lead to reverse migration once necessary groundwork is put into place. Mr. Speaker, sir, this budget is not only about business community or the rich, not at all. Mr. Speaker, it's all for visions, focusing on the unfortunate and the needy in our rural communities. Mr. Speaker, sir, government has demonstrated its commitment in the prioritization of rural development in the coming financial year budget. This will ensure Fijians living in rural areas have the same level of access to essential services and economic opportunities as anywhere else in the country. In addition to the budget allocated to the ministry, Mr. Speaker, sir, government has allocated funds in other ministries across the sectors in the government of developing the rural and maritime regions. To name a few, a sum of 59.4 million is allocated for rural roads, 6.4 million for rural water supply program, 9.4 million for rural electrification, 2 million for reforestation, 1 million for maritime pine development, 530,000 for rural banking services, 0.8 million for drainage for rural residential areas, and the list goes on. Of course, Mr. Speaker, sir, there are other programs in the resource-based ministries that can assist farmers to graduate from subsistence to semi-commercial and commercial production. There are programs in the Ministry of Commerce, Tourism, Trade and Transport to assist in human capital development, which is crucial for growth and sustainability, for economic empowerment projects implemented by our rural and maritime citizens. Mr. Speaker, sir, we need to work smarter with the allocation given and do more with less. We need to prioritize commitments and put in place concrete actions and accessible projects for immediate interventions. Mr. Speaker, sir, government is aware of the fact that our rural areas are resource rich, but the majority are cash poor. We have to appreciate the potential wealth and economic gains that we can derive from the proper management of our natural resources. All efforts, therefore, must now be made to unlock this potential, to convert resources like land into cash, and to generate rural wealth. At the same time, address food security and reduce our import bills while boosting our exports, and ultimately improve the living standard and the quality of life for citizens in our rural communities. The ministry will continue to utilize the funds allocated to the self-help program and the community access roads, food paths, and food bridges to implement projects targeted at these objectives and goals. I would like to also mention that we will work towards ensuring that disaster risk reduction and sustainability are factors to be considered in the selection of the identified projects. Mr. Speaker, sir, with the $1 million allocation in the new budget for self-help programs, communities are encouraged to initiate their socio-economic sustainable development projects on a cost-sharing basis to instill a sense of ownership over these incentives. The arrangement has eased the burdens, especially on those in rural areas who come forward to us to access this program in the last 3 years. Government has invested about $5 million for the 395 multi-sectoral projects. This speaks volume of government priority for rural development. To assist in living standards in our rural communities, Mr. Speaker, sir, the ministry will utilize funding received under its community access roads, footpaths and footbridges program. In the last 3 years, government has invested about $4.5 million for 145 community access projects throughout the country. Mr. Speaker, sir, government is setting aside another $2 million to enable us to deliver more on rural infrastructure projects under the CAF program. The program has not only eased transportation access to those in these remote rural communities, but has also made access to markets easier for farmers in rural Fiji. Mr. Speaker, sir, it would be remiss of me not to highlight that in the 2019 to 20 budget financial year, the ministry implemented 77 infrastructure projects under its CAF program, benefiting more than 11,000 Fijians in remote rural communities. To allow government to extend the reach of its services to the people, government has strategically placed stations to serve the 14 provinces and districts throughout remote rural communities in Fiji. Also included in is a station on the island of Rotuma. Mr. Speaker, sir, currently government is constructing 3 district administration offices, which should be completed and ready for commissioning in the first and second quarter of the next financial year. These are the Kavala Government Station in Kandavu, the Wainikoro Government Station in Maduata, and the Namarai Government Station in Ra. This is a testament of government intention of ensuring Fijian in our rural communities are able to access our service at their doorstep. Mr. Speaker, sir, more than 30,000 Fijians from 63 villages and settlements from these 3 provinces are expected to benefit from the implementation of these projects. Mr. Speaker, sir, the Ministry is again thankful that players of our offices working in the rural and maritime areas have been heard. This is an allocation of 0.4 million in the Ministry budget to commence with repairs and maintenance of residential quarters. Our government has emphasizing leaving no one behind. This is a testimony that the welfare of our officers are also being looked after. We strongly believe that this will lift the morale of our officers working in the divisions. Mr. Speaker, sir, the Ministry is already working towards the strengthening of the integrated rural development framework. In the recent months, there has been an increase in collaboration with the key agencies to prepare the Ministry in improving its planning for rural development and implementation of programs. Mr. Speaker, sir, in fact, the ministry has bigger plans for the new financial year 2020-2021. The Ministry is developing a 10-year strategic plan targeting effective coordination with all government and non-government agencies in the hope to transform rural areas from their hardships to thriving, resilient communities. Mr. Speaker, sir, from my experience living in the village in the past years, I have noticed and observed the potential and opportunities available to our rural communities with the abundance of natural resources. We will do all that we can to ensure that the plight of our rural communities and the marginalized are addressed, and for equality in the delivery of service to all citizens, regardless of where they live, their gender, their age, and their status in society. Mr. Speaker, sir, the Ministry will work within our budget to improve the quality of people's lives and expanding their ability to shape their own future by exploring income-generating opportunities, along with amenities and services. Our Ministry aspiration is to formulate a new strategic plan that will focus on the remolding of the Ministry's program to address development needs I have already made reference to. Mr. Speaker, sir, partnership and collaboration with the government, ministries, non-government organizations, private sector, and development partners are going to be at the heart of the radical transformation in the rural areas. These players are important as they all contribute to the supply chain process from production to service delivery using resource in the rural areas. We plan to tap into resources made available by these partners to complement the Ministry's Community Capacity Building Program funds to enhance human capital and facilitate changing mindset and behavior of recipients of government assistance. Through such incentives, we will ensure that we inculcate a culture of resilience and sustainability in development. Mr. Speaker, sir, inclusive participatory approach in rural development is in line with the government vision to build a better Fiji for all and leaving no one behind. We all know that the rural transformation will not happen overnight. All the old famous saying by John Haywood goes, quote, Rome was not built by day, but they were lying bricks every hour, unquote. Mr. Speaker, sir, the ministry is determined to persevere and be agents of change and agents of growth for our rural and maritime citizens in this new journey post-COVID-19. Finally, Mr. Speaker, sir, I wish to congratulate the Honorable Minister for Economy and his team for putting together this bold budget, and I wish to express my utmost support towards the 2020-2021 budget.